from Psalm 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Beautiful words from God's Word. It was good to see y'all today. Thank you for being here. Hope you had a good 4th of July, good holiday, and we're looking forward to a good service today. The Lord's here, and He's got something to say to us from His Word. We're going to share a time of Holy Communion, and this is going to be a good service. You're going to be glad that we're here. Today, I want to draw your attention to something in the bulletin that we're doing a little differently. We're trying to always work on our order of service to make it better, and this is one of those things. You'll notice that we moved the kids' corner to right after the chimes. Now, Miss Debbie plays the chimes. She sounds the chimes, maybe 11 of them. And remember, during that time, we were praying for people around us, for people that we know who are in need of prayer. You just call their names out before the Lord silently at each chime. So you kids, you pray for somebody, you pray for 11 people. Just call their name out before God. Just say their names in your mind. When the 11th one sounds, Miss Judy today is doing kids' corner. When the 11th one sounds, she's going to get up from her seat and she's going to sit in the chair, and that will be the sign for our kids to come forward for kids' corner. So this is where kids' corner is going to be for a little while. It's right at the very beginning of the service, right after the sounding of the chimes. And we think this will make our service a little bit better. Now also, I want to tell you that next Sunday is our Gideon Sunday. We've never had it in the middle of summer, but we're having it this year in the middle of summer for a reason. When they were in our area this year, in fact last year, you may remember it's been 2 years since we had a Gideon speaker. The reason is because last year we weren't contacted at all, we were overlooked somehow. This year, when they were in our area, it was right after our revival, and I didn't think that was a good time. And so then we were going to wait a month, and the Gideon that I wanted, the speaker that I was requesting, was having surgery, and he couldn't travel for a while. Well, he's ready to go, and he's going to be here next week. Elton Wright is going to be our Gideon speaker, and he was track coach at Forestville High School for years and years and years. And you can look at me and tell that I didn't know. No amens here. That's not the right spot. He was one of my teachers when I was at Forest Hill, and he and his family also attended the same church that I did. And so I'm looking forward to having Elton here. In fact, a couple of years ago, he was the Gideon speaker, I think, over at the Methodist Church. He came by the house. I didn't know he was in town. He came by the house afterwards. But looking forward to seeing him again, looking forward to hearing what he's got to say. But Gideon's doing amazing work, and it's an encouragement to our walk in Christ to hear how God is using His Word, even in this day, to win people to Christ and to work great things in people's lives. And I hope we could be here to experience it this time. And of course, they're coming, and we will receive a love offering for the work of the Gideons next Sunday. So, just did it. Chimes and prayer.
Thank you. there's a little bit. Has that ever happened? I remember seeing that we had, that is scary. What scares you? Black widows. Anything besides spiders scare you? Bears. Very close, and you can just picture yourself right there.
receptive, and that we might be responsible to the Spirit of God. But we thank you. We thank you just to be able to come together. We thank you for this church, Lord, that you have put here, for each one in this church. Lord, help us to be with you without us to be. Help us to be your body. Lord, help us to be your voice, your word, and your voice piece, Lord, and your, just, Lord, to do your work in this community and beyond. We thank you for how you bless. I just believe God is blessing us in these messages through Ephesians. I hope that you're continuing to pray about them and pray for me as I prepare them, as I try to listen to what it is that God has to say. We're now making it to the third chapter, and God has been saying some wonderful things to us. Now today I just want to read two verses 1 and verse 14 of chapter 3. But those two verses, while they're short, they are still God's Word, and we want to show our respect and our honor for His Word. Would you please stand with me and read those? Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. And you see, he interrupts his thought. He resumes that thought in verse 14. For this reason, I kneel before the Father. Father, I pray today that you would fill this place with your Spirit. That you would take the reading and the proclamation of your Word, Lord, and use it in a mighty way. As your Spirit moves among us, Lord, I pray that there will be conviction of sin, there will be comforting of our hearts, and Lord, an encouragement to walk closer to you as we go through our days. Thank you for hearing us and for being present today. In Jesus' name. Thomas Hearn of Dorset, England, made a name for himself many years ago as a hero of Arctic exploration. Once he was searching for the mouth of the Coppermine River in the frozen extreme north of Canada. He wrote that only a few days after they had started on their expedition, a party of Indians stole most of their supplies. Now at that point, Thomas Hearn and the members of his group had a choice. They could have found a place to sit, looked around them, and moaned about their troubles. They could have given up and gone home. Or they could have pushed ahead. Which one would we have chosen? But you see, they had their eyes on the goal, and even though it was distant, it was far more interesting and far more important than going home. This is what Korner wrote about their decision. He said, the weight of our baggage being so much lightened, our next day's journey was more swift and pleasant. You see, his perspective was that now that they didn't have so much to pack around, they could move around easier and faster. Their choice was to look around or look ahead. Their perspective made a world of difference. They eventually found and followed the Coppermine River until they finally stood on the shore of the partially frozen sea in July of 1771. The journey was difficult, but that did not stop them from pressing forward to meet their goal. As we continue our tour of the Grand Canyon of Scripture, we finally come to what we know as chapter 3. Paul begins verse 1 there by saying, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. And then he begins talking about something else. Now, if you read Paul's letters carefully, you'll notice that he does this frequently. He begins thinking about talking about something, and then his thought is interrupted by some grander thought, and he'll start talking about it before returning to his original thought. And that's what he does here. He begins talking about something else, and he doesn't continue that thought again until verse 14. So if you'll see how they're tied together, the words "for this reason" in verses 1 and verse 14 point back to the closing words of chapter 2. And there he used the metaphor of all of us being joined together into one living building in which God lives by his Spirit. And then he resumes in verse 14 by saying, for this reason I kneel before. But there's something buried right here in verse 1 that we focus on today. Paul has some lofty ideas and grand doctrines to write about, and we've uncovered some of them as we move through on our tour. But don't miss the fact that Paul was in prison when he wrote this letter. Did you see that? He says, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner. Now how did Paul wind up in prison? Well, he preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. He proclaimed that through Christ, God had included the Gentiles in his plan of salvation. seem to be that important. But notice how he phrases this. He says, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus. Pay attention to that. He didn't see himself as a prisoner of the Romans. He wasn't a prisoner of Caesar. He was a prisoner of Christ Jesus. That perspective made a lot of difference for Paul. And it can make a lot of difference for us. But what does that mean, a prisoner of Christ Jesus? It simply meant that even though Paul was under house arrest in Rome, by the Romans, he was there because of Christ. He could have looked around at the circumstances and wondered aloud, or even quietly to himself, why God allowed him to be put in prison. After all, wasn't he doing what God told him to do? Wasn't he being obedient? Wasn't he being faithful? He could have just sat down and said, well, if God's going to treat me this way, I'll just let those Christians back in Ephesus and everywhere else just kind of tend to themselves. I got problems of my own to deal with. He could have said that. He could have looked around him and moaned and groaned about the situation he was in. But instead, look at verse 11. We didn't read that, but I want you to see it. Look at verse 11. Instead, he was looking ahead to the eternal purpose which God accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. He was looking forward to a greater goal, the larger goal in front of him. The goal of seeing that the believers in Ephesus and elsewhere were rooted and grounded, established in the faith. That they might know God better. That they might understand their position in Christ. Remember, that's a major theme of Ephesians. Them being in Christ. That they might live out of that kind of power. He knew that there was a future awaiting the follower of Christ, and he focused on that. He focused on that future in spite of the circumstances in which he found himself. He could have operated from his position in prison or from the position of the power that Christ had given him. Prison or power. The challenge is there for us too. You know that? Think about it. What kind of prison are you in? We can live our lives from the prison of whatever circumstance we find ourselves in. Or we can live from a position of power. Now, a position of power doesn't mean that everything goes the way you want it to. It means that you're powerful, you're victorious in Christ, in the midst of the situation, whatever it is. When things don't go the way we want them to, when life is turning sour, when the circumstances of our lives are not at all what we would have chosen for ourselves, it is extremely easy for us to look at all of that around us and allow that to paralyze us. But one real good way to measure our spiritual maturity is to look at how we respond to circumstances when they don't go the way we want them to, when they're not what we want. I want to tell you about some friends of mine. I'm sharing their stories with their permission. The first one is my friends Durward and Jeannie Blanks. Now, Durward was here a couple of years ago. He sat right there. He's the guy that looked like Santa Claus. Y'all remember him? In fact, he does. He does do Santa for many times a year, even in the summer months sometimes. But Durward and Jeannie Blanks live in Nashville, Tennessee. Now, some time ago, they had been leasing a 4,000 square foot home, and they were hoping to purchase it one day. But then the phone call came one day that house had been sold right at the front of them. They had 30 days to move. Well, they wound up in a travel trailer in a KOA campground near Opryland, most of their belongings in storage, and they've been there for quite some time, living in a travel trailer. Now, some of us would complain about that. I know I would. I wouldn't like that at all, but not Durwood Gene. They could have looked around at their situation, but instead they looked forward. They keep trying to serve the Lord and be obedient to His will in the meantime. You see, here's just a couple of examples. While they had been there at the campground, they met a family. from a northern state. And they were living in a one-room cabin there in the campground, a one-room cabin with one bedroom. They had three children and no beds for the children. Well, my friends, Durwood and Jeannie pulled mattresses out of storage so those kids would have a place to sleep. They started a Bible study right there in the campground. They reached many people who do not know the Lord Jesus. And this is what Durwood wrote. He said, "So I go about serving one person at a time. God has taken us from living in excess to learning to rely on Him daily. One day, we will be back in a house. For the time being, we know we are where He has sent us." Now, these next words, I want you to pay attention to them and see if they don't sound a little bit like Thomas Hearne from 1771. He said, "We've eliminated a lot of our excess. Much of it was preventing us from fully serving God. As we shed the excess, we began to see His will for our lives more clearly." Another friend is named Rebecca Moreau. We went to high school together. Durwood and I went to high school together, but he was in a couple of classes ahead of me. Rebecca tells me that when her first husband, Charlie, was dying, that she felt an overwhelming sense of peace. And she said, this is how it happened. She knew his body was winding down, and she sat in a large chair there across from his bed in the hospital room. And she said this feeling came over her that she was, as she's sitting in this large chair, that she was sitting in God's lap. God had His arms wrapped around her. And God told her that she was going to be okay. Her children were going to be okay. And she had that time of fellowship with the Lord, and then she got up and she moved to Charlie's bedside. He's not able to respond to her. And she told him that she was going to be okay. God had given her that assurance that she and the children were going to be okay. Within the hour, he took a turn for the worse, was rushed into ICU, and soon passed away. You know, as a young widow with three small children, Rebecca could have looked at her circumstances and given up. But her faith helped her to look ahead. Another friend of mine is Joe Ginn. Now, Joe used to attend church here a few years ago. Some of you remember Joe. Joe also was a couple of years ahead of me in high school. We went to the same church. Joe lives now in West Monroe, Louisiana. In April of 2012, he had a heart attack. Pretty serious one. He described a peace that enveloped him. Even though I should have been scared. A heart cath revealed three severe blockages, 70, 80, and 90%, and one minor one. But the doctor said, "Joe, bypass surgery is your only option, but we can't operate for a few days. You're not ready for that kind of surgery." The doctor said, "I don't operate on anyone unless God gives me clear permission to proceed." Now, Joe could have looked around him and thought, "I'm in such bad shape I can't even do surgery." Because that's basically what they said. "I'm in such bad shape they can't even do surgery." But listen, he didn't say, "Why me?" He didn't say, "I'm in big trouble now." He looked ahead. And his doctor, a believer himself, obviously, even commented on Joe's attitude. To which Joe replied, "It's my faith in God. It's not my power doing this. It's His." Prison or power? You see a pattern here? All of us are going to have problems. Every one of us. Every one of us will face difficulty and trial, and some of us are going to go through a lot of it. We can't do a lot to avoid much of what comes our way, can we? It's there. But our faith as believers in Christ provides a perspective that makes a huge difference. Whether the difficulty is a life-changing one or even just a little nagging inconvenience. Sometimes it's not the life-changing things that mess up our days. It's just a little bitty, nagging little thing here and a little bit of thing over here, and suddenly our day is ruined. Prison or power? There were two women who met a frog on the street. And the frog spoke up and said, "If you kiss me, I'll turn into a rich, handsome fellow." Well, one of the women just reached down and picked him up and put him in her purse. And the second woman said, "Well, aren't you going to kiss him?" And the first woman said, "No, a talking frog is really worth something." See, her perspective was that a talking frog was worth a whole lot more than a handsome, rich man. Some of you ladies are thinking, "Well, she was pretty smart." We all have ideas about what would be the most meaningful to us. And every day we're faced with choices. And we have choices about how we're going to respond, about how we're going to react to circumstances. We may not be under Roman arrest, but we do have a choice. We can choose to focus all of our attention, all of our energies, and our fears on what's going on around us. But listen, when the Bible talks about, here especially in Ephesians, we've already seen some of it, when the Bible talks about power, the power of the Spirit, the power of Jesus, the power that God has given us and is working in our lives through Christ, He didn't intend for us to use that power to be afraid all the time, and to complain all the time, and to gripe all the time. He intended for us to use that power He's given us to be victorious. To rise above those things, even if they are horrible things. Even if they're terrible things. In the little country church that I once pastored near Benton, Mississippi, there was one family several years ago who had been going through an extended period of uncertainty regarding the husband's job. You see, the company that he worked for had been on the verge of going out of business for almost a year. And you know, he didn't know from one day to the next when he went into work whether he was going to have a job. The official announcement just never seemed to come. And as you can imagine, that was of great concern to him and his family. And in fact, the entire church family was praying for them, was concerned for them. But one Wednesday evening, I walked into the church sanctuary for the prayer service, and I was greeted by the couple's only child, Jessica, precious 5-year-old. Now, she's still precious, but she's in college. So this is quite a while ago. Jessica came up to me and she announced that she had some great news. Her dad had found another job. And we all celebrated. Several people who were there had already heard the story, so everybody was watching to see my reaction and listen to what she had to say. And then her dad said, "Well, tell Dr. Rocky what that means." And Jessica's eyes lit up and she said, "It means we still get to go to Wendy's." See, the perspective of a child is a lot different from that of an adult, right? Going to Wendy's or any other fast food restaurant was the last thing on her mom and dad's minds, right? The same is true in our lives as Christians. We can be spiritual 5-year-olds about our situations, or we can grow up into Christ and approach our problems with faith and hope in the Lord God. One thing, though, is certain. Our perspective is always affected by our faith in Christ. Always. Always. And I see somebody who's always sour about everything and always, everything is wrong and everybody's against me and all of this. I just have to wonder, what kind of faith does that person have? Does that person even know Jesus? That's not the Jesus that I read about in the Bible. That's not the Jesus that died on the cross for my sins. That's not the Jesus that saved me. Yeah, life is hard. And sometimes it's overwhelming. And we just want to, you know, we keep looking at that problem and this one, that one, and this one over here. And here comes another one right behind me. And we seem like some. sometimes we just barely get over one problem before here comes another. That is life. The way it is. Doesn't mean God's punishing you. It doesn't mean God hates you. It doesn't mean anybody's out to get you. That's life. And all of us go through those things. Just some of us handle them a little better than others. You know what the secret is? The secret is faith in Christ. The secret is not looking around. The secret is looking ahead. That's the secret. And in the meantime, regardless of the circumstances that crowd their way into our lives, we can live with joy and peace. Look at verse 7. We'll come back to those verses in between in another week. But look at verse 7. Paul said that he became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Now he's in prison. And he's talking about being a servant of Christ. Through power. Through power. And we can live in that power, even though we may not be in the most ideal situation. See, it has nothing to do with that. Don't get too confused. We can still look forward with faith, knowing that our Heavenly Father is working to strengthen us and encourage us in the Spirit. Yeah, you know, you look at the news and you follow what's happening and you read about Supreme Court decisions and edicts that are issued from the Oval Office and all kinds of things and you see how it trickles down into our society, and it seems that our world is more and more determined to oust God and all of his followers from our culture. And yes, it seems that the world is getting darker and darker all the time. We can look at the news and we can think, it sure doesn't look very good for us Christians, does it? Or we can look ahead. We can look ahead to the time when Jesus will return in glory to restore his kingdom. In the meantime, maybe those words ought to be a slogan or a motto for us believers. In the meantime. In the meantime, we can make a difference for the kingdom of God and in the lives of others. I want to be a little hard with you right now. But I can be hard because I have been through this and I know what I'm talking about. You wonder why God doesn't solve your problem for you? It may be that God has a very special mission for you right there where you are. And as a result of going through this time, this difficulty, this trial, God is equipping you to serve him in a way past that that you could never dream of right now. That difficult job? Yes. That unhappy marriage? Yes. That serious illness? Absolutely. That seemingly impossible condition? Oh, yes. And even in the most uncomfortable, most distressing, most discouraging circumstance, our God is still God, and he still reigns. So, I want to ask you today, will you trust him today? To trust him to know what he is doing, even if you can't figure it out, even if it doesn't make any sense to you at all? Will you stop looking so much at the circumstances that are surrounding you and lift your eyes to Jesus and what he has in store for you yet to come? The best, folks, is still ahead of us. And I'm not necessarily talking about this life, but God might do just exactly that. The best part of your life, no matter how old you are, or where you've been, and what you're going through right now, may still be ahead of you. But even if not, you know that on the other side of eternity, when you pass through that door into those gates of heaven and you see Jesus stand up and welcome you home, You see Jesus. Now you keep doing that, I'm gonna keep preaching. No, keep doing it. I'm just kidding. When you see Jesus stand up and welcome you home and throw his arms around you in a great big bear hug, and he says, welcome home to you, all these things that you're going through will be of no consequence whatsoever. None. Now, I haven't been to heaven yet. But I read the words and I believe the words of the one who created heaven. And he's the one who told us how to get there. And he's the one who's told us just a little bit about what it's like. About what it's like. So, today you are either operating from prison or from power. And I can tell you right now that prison is not God's will and purpose for you. Not. Which will you choose? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. Just bow your head right where you are. I'm not asking you to stand. I'm not asking you to make any movement toward the front. I am asking you, though, to examine your own heart and your own life. Let God's Holy Spirit speak to you right where you are. It is impossible that the Lord wants to do something in your life that you've never even dreamed of. Is it possible that today God has something he wants to say to you that he's been saying to you all along, but you haven't heard it because your voice has been raised too much in complaint? It's a funny thing. When I raise my voice in complaint, I can't hear God, but when I raise my voice in praise, I hear every word he says. And I may not always understand, and I might not always rest in peace and in what he's doing in my life. But I can know deep inside of me that God has a purpose and a plan for everything. We're not here by an accident. The things that happen to us in a day's time are not by accident. The seemingly horrible twists and turns that our lives take are not accidental. This dead is going to play something silently here. Thank you for being sensitive to that, Debbie. She's going to be playing something silently here, and I'm just going to ask you if the Lord has spoken to you and says, and he said to you, I want you to change your way, and I want you to trust me more, follow me more carefully, with no one looking around. All you have to do is just raise your hand. Wash your place. Just raise your hand. Those of you who raised your hands, I'm not going to call your name now. I'm not going to say anything to you. But I think I can remember who all of you were, and I assure you that I'm going to be praying for you. God has some wonderful things he wants to do here. And maybe he will start right there in your heart. Deacons, would you join me here for our time of Holy Communion? refuses to sit out there because if they sat closer to me, he refuses to, who was preaching today. Remember, we always cover our elements of communion, and we always fold this cloth as a symbol, a reminder to us of the resurrection. Because when the disciples went into the empty tomb, they saw that linen cloth that had surrounded Jesus, folded up, and in a place over by itself. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? And so God gave us this observance as a reminder of what all the wonderful things He has done. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's chapter 11, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" This represents the body of Christ, which has been broken for you. Eat all of it. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament, my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." represents for us the precious blood of Christ. Drink all of it. The very next verse in that passage from 1 Corinthians 11, Paul says, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Right there, we're remembering him, remembering what he did for us, but we're also looking forward. We're not just looking around, we're looking ahead for that day when Jesus is going to come back. Now, guys, hand me your cups. There's seven cups here on the table. I want y'all to do something. They don't know about this, so they're thinking, what in the world happens? I want y'all to help me pronounce the blessing. All right? Hands up. If you can do that, good. If you can't, that's all right. Blessing on the people. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.